الحمد لله رب العالمين حمدا حمدا يوافي نعمه ويكفئ مزيده اللهم لك الحمد كله ولك الشكر كله وإله وإليك يرجع الأمر كله على نيته وسر الفاتحة that Allah سبحانه وتعالى grants us إخلاص and توفيق and قبول that He سبحانه وتعالى shares this gathering with His love and with His mercy and with His care that He سبحانه وتعالى gives everyone of us what we aim for in طاعة عافية and صلاح حال ظهر وباطن على هذه النية وكل نية صالحنا والصالحين ومشيخنا أجمعين إلى حضرة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم Ameen. Alhamdulillah, we are at the end of the month of Rajab and we are witnessing at the same time three things. One is the this evening in which we were reading the story of the birthday of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The other is the great month of Rajab, which is an introduction to the month of Ramadan. And the third is the occasion of the prophetic night journey and ascension. And since the talk of tonight is about the conduct of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his character sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one of the essentials that we can see throughout the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the prophetic quality of returning to Allah at times of need. We definitely live at times of troubles and problems. At the level of an individual, we have our day-to-day challenges, problems that we face. At the level of a family, we have problems and issues. At the level of a society at large, we have issues that face us and trouble us. Externally and internally, challenge our faith and challenge our hearts and challenge our belief and challenge our minds. We become completely perplexed, confused, wouldn't know what to do. And even at the level of the Ummah, since we live at the end of times, when we look around ourselves, we see that there is so much confusion and there is so much problems. People are navigating a sea that they are unable to actually swim through it. They're trying to navigate through a sea while they are completely unqualified to swim. And with this, they harm themselves more than they benefit themselves. They forget in the middle of all of this that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam left us with a big heritage and a big rope to salvation that is called returning to Allah at times of difficulties and needs. In order to understand the occasion of Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj and the prophetic conduct during this stage in the prophetic life, we need to go back a few years before Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj. And let's go to this time when Khabbab ibn al-Arat radiyallahu anhu. Khabbab ibn al-Arat was a blacksmith. He was someone who worked for a lady, very harsh, hard lady, who persecuted him for his religion, persecuted him when he embraced Islam. And she used to command other slaves to carry Khabbab radiallahu anhu, put him upside down on the coal, on the fire, until they could smell from his back the smell of his flesh, the grilling of his flesh. And then they would grab him, they would drag him from his legs, from his feet, across the streets of Mecca al-Mukarramah until he loses all the flesh in his back. In the middle of this torture, Khabbab ibn al-Arat radiallahu anhu comes to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and he says, if we are on the truth, why don't you ask Allah to help us? Ala tastansir lana. We need some form of help. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam could have met Khabbab at that time with some soothing words that would make him feel that there is a bit of victory, earthly victory that is on the make. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, unlike his normal character, he gave Khabbab some disciplining words. He said to him, people before you used to be cut from the top of their heads to the bottom of their feet to their toes, from head to toe, and none of them would even think twice. They never thought of leaving their religion. They never thought of leaving their faith. but you are in haste. وَلَكِنَّكُمْ تَسْتَعْجِلُونَ. You are in haste. And this is a prophetic principle that we will find manifest throughout the life of the Prophet ﷺ. That was probably during the time when Khabbab radiallahu an and the rest of the believers were tortured. That's about 4 or 5 years after the Ba'atha, after the Prophet ﷺ received the first revelation. A few years down the line, the Prophet ﷺ, if we can say, received a blow after a blow from Quraysh, persecuting his people, persecuting him ﷺ, calling him names, trying to damage his image all over Arabia, and that all ended with boycotting him sallallahu alayhi wasallam. A complete boycott that has pushed the people of Banu Hashim into their valley and blocked them there and stopped any form of assistance, any form of food from them. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and his people found themselves starving, no food, no marriage, no communication, nothing of any sort of assistance and help, no form of cooperation, no form of human contact for 3 years. And when we talk about things like these, we take them quite light, because we can never imagine or visualize or feel the pain the Prophet ﷺ and his community have gone through. With this, as the Prophet ﷺ came out of the years of boycott, 3 years of boycott that ended in a specific way, Abu Talib, the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was told by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent an earthworm to eat the scripture, the manuscript where they wrote the boycott agreement, where they wrote the manifestation declaring boycott to Banu Hashim. And the boycott came to an end with these words of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through this miracle has shown this form of boycotting and cutting ties of kith and kin is completely inhumane. As soon as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came from this difficult time, we find him facing another blow. That is the loss of his uncle Abu Talib and his wife as Sayyida Khadija radiallahu anha. Now Quraysh, who were already harming and hurting the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his community, they doubled or tripled or even increased their harm for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tenfold. What would you do in a situation like that? What would you do in a situation like that? You will try to find other avenues in life. And sometimes in our day-to-day life, we are faced by blows of life. Life punches you, kills you sometimes. Sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala lets or unleashes difficulties one after another, successive difficulties. You lose your job. And then in the middle of everything, something happens to your children. And possibly even something happened to your family. And something possibly in the middle of all of this from stress, you discover that you have a disease, a physical disease, that you discover something that is really terrifying. So you find yourself almost cut from everywhere. You think, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala depicts in the Quran, ضَاقَتْ عَلَيْهِمُ الْأَرْضُ بِمَا رَحُبَتْ. You realize that even though this land, this earth is so wide, but it's so tight. It is so wide and so big, but it is so tight. It is as if, as the poet says, كَأَنَّ الدُّنْيَا قَلَبَتْ لَهُ ظَهْرَ الْمِجَنِ. As if life has turned its back to you. Life completely turned its back to you. Luck has given you its back, has bid you a complete farewell. Every time you try to look for some relief, the relief does not come to you. In fact, instead of the relief, it just gets tighter and tighter. You think that you can have a solution by taking a step and realize that this new step is actually bringing you more trouble and more problems. So what happens? Things become very difficult to you. The Prophet ﷺ received a blow after another blow. His companions were tortured and persecuted. He just came out of a boycott. Then he lost his uncle Abu Talib, the one who could speak to Quraysh and negotiate with them, the one who can defend him in front of Quraysh, the one who was stopping Quraysh from killing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, hurting the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam because of his status in Quraysh, and then even losing his wife. You know, in life in general, you might have failure in your outer front, but as long as your internal front is strong, you can take things. As long as you can come home and you complain to someone and they can soothe you with some words of ease, you have hope to continue. The Prophet ﷺ, and this is an area in the life of the Prophet ﷺ that no one talks about. That no one talks about. That the Prophet ﷺ became a single father at a certain point in his life. He had children with the Sayyidah Khadija radiallahu anha. And all of a sudden, as Sayyidah Khadija radiallahu anha passed away, and she left him with an outer responsibility and internal responsibility. Imagine that you have lost your job and you're looking for a job, and then all of a sudden something happens in the house, and then you are lost and you are left with the children. Then you don't know what to do. How can you continue looking for a job externally and at the same time you fulfill your duties internally? The Prophet ﷺ, in the middle of all of this, he lost his wife, Sayyidah Khadija radiallahu anha. Forget about the financial support, but remember, more importantly, the spiritual support that she used to give to the Prophet ﷺ. Remember that Sayyidah Khadija radiallahu anha was the first one who received the Prophet ﷺ after he came back running from the cave of Hira. She is the one who told him that Allah will never disgrace you, Allah will never forsake you. Sayyidah Khadija radiallahu anha was this pillar inside the house of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, to which he salawatullahi wasalamu alayhi always resorted, and to which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam always refuged whenever he had terrible time. No wonder the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, many years later, he said, "She believed in me when everyone disbelieved in me. She helped me when everyone has forsaken me. She shared her money and her wealth with me when I had no money. آمنت بي حين كفر بي الناس وآوتني حين أنكرني الناس وواستني بمالها." And she shared her money, her wealth with me. ورزقني الله منها الولد. And Allah gave me children with her. In the middle of all of this, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is facing external challenge, an internal challenge. What would be his conduct, sallallahu alaihi wasallam? He tries new avenues for da'wah. He left Mecca and went to At-Taif, walking to At-Taif, trying new places for da'wah. And this is something that, since we're talking about prophetic conduct, we have to bear in mind that in the middle of your trouble, when you think that there is no other way that you can move, there is no new path that you can walk, remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala might be directing you to discover new avenues. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala might be trying to push you to discover new avenues. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala pressurizes you so that you discover that you have an ability to take pressure. Sometimes we live in our comfort zones and we don't discover the abilities, the amazing abilities and power that we have as human beings. When you work under stress, you realize that you have got a lot of potential. When you have challenges, you discover, as they say in Arabic, Al-Hajah Ummul Ikhtira'. Need is the mother of invention. Only when people need, they have to look for new avenues. If there is no need, there will be no avenues. We as human beings are complacent. We don't want to try anything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala might make it tight for you in one place so that you move to a different direction. He subhanahu wa ta'ala is opening new avenues for you. As we always repeat the words of Sayyidina Ibn Ata'illah Sakandari, that إِنَّمَا يُؤْلِمُكَ الْمَنْعِ لِعَدَمِ فَهْمِكَ عَنِ اللَّهِ فِيهِ. You feel the pain of deprivation only because you don't understand. If Allah opens the gates of understanding for you, you will realize that He is not depriving, He is actually giving. We misunderstand deprivation. We misunderstand deprivation. In fact, in every deprivation, there is a gift. In every deprivation, there is a gift. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deprives you from food and drink in the month of Ramadan, but He is giving you loads. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala might make things tight for you so that you go out and discover and travel. In the Quran, we are told of those people who will be punished on the day of Qiyamah because they never made a space and they never made an initiative of exploration when they were tight. الَّذِينَ تَتَوَفَّاهُمُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ ظَالِمِي أَنفُسِهِمْ. Those whom angels will take in death and they have done injustice to themselves. Why did they do injustice to themselves? They never traveled to be free to worship Allah. When it was tight for them, they remained in their places. تَتَوَفَّاهُمُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ ظَالِمِي أَنفُسِهِمْ قَالُوا فِيمَ كُنْتُمْ. They say to them, What was your situation? Why did you remain where you were? قَالُوا كُنَّا مُسْتَضْعَفِينَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. They said, we were persecuted in the land. We were not able to worship Allah in freedom. قَالُوا أَلَمْ تَكُنْ أَرْضُ اللَّهِ وَاسِعَةً فَتُهَاجِرُ فِيهَا. Didn't you realize that the land is open? As this Arab poet says, كَمْ تَشْتَكِي وَتَقُولُ إِنَّكَ مُعْدَمُ. How often you complain and you say you've got nothing. وَالْأَرْضُ حَوْلَكَ وَالسَّمَى وَالْأَنْجُمُ. Like, look at the earth around you. Look at the heavens. Look at the stars. وَلَكَ الْحُقُولُ وَزَرْعُهَا وَرَبِيعُهَا وَنَسِيمُهَا وَالْبُلْبُلُ الْمُتَرَنِّبُ. Look at the fields. Hasn't He given you, subhanahu wa ta'ala, eyes that you can see with? Hasn't He given you faculties? You have a lot that we don't think of. وَالْمَاءُ حَوْلَكَ فِضَّةٌ رَقْرَاقَةٌ وَالشَّمْسُ فَوْقَكَ عَسْجَدٌ يَتَرَنَّمُ. Like, look at the water. You can hear the breeze of water. You can hear the sound of water. What would you be willing to pay in order to receive just this faculty of being able to hear? Just this faculty of being able to see? We read in the books of history this famous story of Abu Ja'far al-Mansur, this famous Abbasi Khalifa, the man who owned the earth, when he invited Abu Khazim, one of the Salihin, and he sat with him. Then Abu Ja'far al-Mansur looked at the clouds and he said, you can rain wherever you want. The land revenue, the revenue of the land where you will rain will come to me. He's boasting with his huge kingdom, saying to the clouds, you can rain wherever you wish. For whatever place you are going to rain, the crops of that place will come back to me. Then Abu Khazim waited, and the Khalifa ordered for a glass of water. So when the glass of water was offered to him, Abu Khazim said, before you drink, how much will you pay if you are unable to have access to this water? If you can't drink water, if you can't digest food, if you can't have what you're enjoying, how much will you pay for to be treated from that? He said, half of my kingdom. Then he let him drink. And then he said, now let me ask you one more question. How much will you pay for that water to come out of you? Imagine it's inside you and you're unable to get rid of it. How much will you pay for that? Then he said, half of my kingdom. He said, then your kingdom is just like a glass of water. It's not even the worth of a glass of water. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala might be squeezing you just to show you, to shape you, to formulate you. As we always put good metals and bad metals both in fire so that we separate them. You can't shape gold unless you put it in fire. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala let all of these difficulties face His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam because He's our example. So He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to explore new venues in At-Ta'if, meeting different people, offering His message to them. And then He didn't achieve much luck in His endeavor because these people were deprived of seeing the Muhammadan light. So He salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi decided to make His way back to Mecca, and we know that they asked their children, like lay people, insignificant people, to throw stones at Him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, nafsi lahu fida. And here is the lesson. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam raises his hands to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He raises his hands, turns to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at that time. اللهم إليك أشكو ضعف قوتي وقلة حيلتي وهواني على الناس. Oh Allah, to you I complain of lack of power. And when we look at this dua of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, we discover that it has three keys that each and every one of us will depend on any to show that he has power. The sources of power in life in general are one of three. Either you have physical power, or you have intellectual power, or basically physical or intellectual power, that's something in you, or you don't have any and you have means, you have money, or you're able to think of a way out, or finally you don't have physical power, you don't have intellectual plans, but you've got a family, you've got friends who can help you. These are the sources of power in our life. You're either powerful because of something that relates to you, or you might not have the physical, the material power, but you can think of a way out of a difficulty. Look at, for example, look at the elephants. They're powerful because of their size. Look at the lions. They're powerful because of their ability to devour. You're fearful of them. But look at the ants. They don't have power. Physically, they don't have power. But what do they have? They have plans. They can plan things very well. Certain animals are so small, but they can take different colors in the environment they are in. And with that, they can hide themselves. They take a green color, they take the color of the environment around them, so you won't be able to catch them. They don't have the physical power, but they have the hila. And sometimes you don't have the hila, you don't have the plans, and you don't have the physical power. But you have a family that can help you. You've got in-laws who can extend the hand of help to you. You've got a friend who can help you. You've got someone else who can support you. The people of Sayyidina Salih alayhi salam, they said to Sayyidina Salih, the people of Afwan, Sayyidina Shu'ayb, they said to him, Ya Shu'ayb, ma nafqahu kathiran mimma taqul, wa inna lanaraka fina da'ifan. Like, we don't understand what you're saying to us. For us, you are a weak person. Walawla rahtuka la rajamna. Only because of your tribe, we can't do anything to you. For us, you as an individual, you don't have a value. We're not afraid of you alone, but we are afraid of having to get into trouble with the people around you. These are the sources of power in the lives of any creature in this universe. Either physical power or the power of intellect, thinking. You can think of a way to make yourself look very powerful. Just like some of these lizards who are so small, but when you attack them, they change their color or they change their shape, and then you become frightened. Or some animals who are so weak and you can easily trap them, but what do? They release some offensive smell and people run away. That's a hila. That's a means of protecting oneself. Or some other animals that dig deep, or some animals that pretend that they are dead. Some animals, when you try to catch them, they pretend that they are dead. So you just leave them, walk away. These animals are not powerful in themselves, but they are powerful in their ways. So power is in either in you, or in your ways, or in someone else who can assist you. But what happens when you realize that you have none of these? If you have none of these, there is a fourth source of power that doesn't belong to this universe, that comes from outside this universe. That's the power of Iman. That's the power of hope. That's the power of Allah. That's the power of Iman that runs in your heart and gives you support in times of difficulties. That's the power that can beat any other power. The Prophet ﷺ declared his disconnection, distanced himself from the other three powers. Allahumma ilayka ashku da'afa quwwati. Oh Allah, to you I turn with complete powerlessness. Wa qillata hilati. No plans. I've got no plans. I can't think of any other way. And then lastly, وَهَوَانِي عَلَى النَّاسِ. And I'm insignificant in the eyes of men. I've got no family anymore to support. I've got no one to protect me. My extended family, Quraysh, the man who was in my support, Abu Talib, has passed away. وَقِلَّةَ حِيلَتِي. And my wife, who used to support me internally, has passed away. وَهَوَانِي عَلَى النَّاسِ. And then the fourth one the Prophet ﷺ is turning to is إِلَّمْ يَكُنْ بِكَ عَلَيَّ غَضَبٌ فَلَا أُبَالِي. If you're not upset with me, if you're not displeased with me, as long as my situation with you, my path to you is clear, then I don't bother. Sayyidina Khubayb ibn Adi radiallahu ta'ala an, a Sahabi who many years later was captured by Quraysh and they crucified him. The first Sahabi to be crucified. In his poetry which he recited before they crucified him, he says, وَلَسْتُ أُبَالِي حِينَ أُقْتَلُ مُسْلِمًا عَلَى أَيِّ جَنْبٍ كَانَ فِي اللَّهِ مَطْمَعِي كَانَ فِي اللَّهِ مَصْرَعِي وَذَلِكَ فِي ذَاتِ الْإِلَهِ وَإِنْ يَشَأْ يُبَارِكْ عَلَى أَوْصَالِ شِلْوِ مُمَزَّعِي. I care not if I am killed as a believer, regardless of how they are going to kill me, whether they are going to crucify me, whether they... Abdullah ibn Zubayr radiallahu anhu, when he went to his mother as Sayyida Asma, and Abdullah ibn Zubayr was facing the Umayyads, Al-Hajjaj ibn Yusuf wanted to kill him, and they bombarded the Kaaba to capture Abdullah ibn Zubayr. So Abdullah ibn Zubayr went to as Sayyida Asma. At that time, she was 100 years old. And he said to her, I'm afraid that if they capture me and kill me, they will scathe my skin and mutilate my body. She said to him, a sheep does not feel the pain after it has been slaughtered. A sheep does not feel the pain after it has been slaughtered. A sheep is not harmed by the pain after it has been slaughtered. لا يضر الشاتة سلخها بعد قتلها وبعد ذبحها. The Prophet ﷺ is showing us at the most difficult times, his strength does not come from this world. It comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As long as you are not displeased with me, then I can face anything. I can face anything. إِلَّمْ يَكُنْ بِكَ عَلَيَّ غَضَبْ فَلَا أُبَالِي. I can face anything. I can take anything. The answer to this moment of connection was elevation in Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj. It wasn't a few days until the Prophet ﷺ was taken in Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj. And you know the rest of the story. So here is something that the Prophet ﷺ is leaving us with. That is called turning to Allah at time of need. Returning to Allah at time of need. Moving towards Allah at time of need. Realizing that He subhanahu wa ta'ala is letting all doors closed in your face because He is directing you to the door that is never closed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala might let all doors closed in your face so that He will tell you there is a door that you need to go through, and that door is called the door of Allah. That He subhanahu wa ta'ala will never close. He subhanahu wa ta'ala makes people annoy you so that you turn to Him. As also Ibn Ata'illah mentions, he says, if this dunya shows you some of its ugliness, if this dunya shows you some of its ugliness, you should not be in despair, for it just shows some of its qualities. And if He subhanahu wa ta'ala lets people annoy you? إِنَّمَا أَزْعَجَكَ مِنَ الْخَلْقِ He makes you annoyed with people, restless with people. لِيُوَجَّهَكَ إِلَيْهِ So that you turn to him. You go to him. And then when you are with him, subhanahu wa ta'ala, when you're taken care of by him, subhanahu wa ta'ala, then everything else will come back to you. Sidi Nadar was singing. What is Sidi Nadar? What were you singing in the moonrise? You were saying part where the blessings came to stay. What was that again, Sidi?
All the troubles in the world have gone away.
The blessings in the world have come to stay. Yeah, the troubles are gone. And the blessings have come to stay. If we take the world in that way, then we realize that we're always safe as long as we turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the blessings have come to stay. We'd see that Abu Hassan al-Shadhili radiallahu anhu moved from Tunisia and he came to Egypt. He faced a lot of envious, a lot of people who envied him and caused him trouble. He had to run away from Tunisia because of the troubles that he was going through. When he arrived in the lands of Egypt, he heard someone telling him, ذَهَبَتْ سُنُونُ الْمِحْنَى وَأَقْبَلَتْ سُنُونُ الْمِنَّى The years of difficulty are gone. The years of blessings have arrived. The years of difficulty are over now. Now, it is time. It is time for blessings to open up. Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj was that shifting point between the years of difficulty and the years of blessings. But in the middle of this, in the middle of this move, there was something that we miss. That is turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Raising your hands to Allah at these difficult times. When we look around ourselves, we realize that the most neglected ibadah today is dua. People are politically analyzing the difficult situations of Muslims all over the world. People are analyzing what are we going to do with the next elections? What are we going to do with this? What are we going to do with that? What will they do to Muslims in this country? What will happen if this person does this? What? People are busy with their planning. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't want them to be busy with their planning. You just go to the planner of all plans. Just turn to the one, to the turner of all hearts. Turn to the one who makes the routes. If you want to travel a route, just turn to the one who makes them and ask him to choose for you and to guide you. Gift all your plans to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and say, I have no plans anymore. Say, all my plans have not worked. And I acknowledge that I have no plans. I acknowledge that I have no ways. I acknowledge that I have no power, then your weakness will become your strength. Your weakness will become your strength. Why? Because you are not strong by yourself, you are strong by Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Lut alayhi salam was facing his people and he said, لَوْ أَنَّ لِي بِكُمْ قُوَّةً أَوْ آوِي إِلَىٰ رُكْنٍ شَدِيدٍ He turned to Allah for help and rescue. Nuh alayhi salam, مَا آمَنَ مَعَهُ إِلَّا قَلِيلٌ Only a few accepted him. Who would have ever imagined that Nuh alayhi salam and his people will be the saved group? Who would have believed that Nuh alayhi salam people will turn to him to save them with him in his ark? Who would have believed that Nuh alayhi salam will carry all the creation with him in this small ship? And it is with these couples of human beings and animals that all humanity and other creatures come. Who would have believed at that time in the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that they are just one stone away from Medina? At that moment, 10th year after the Hijrah, right after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was elevated to heavens, and when did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam see the place of their Hijrah? In the night of ascension. In the night journey, when he came back, he said, أُرِيتُ دَارَ هِجْرَتِكُمْ I was shown the abode of your hijrah. أَرْضٌ سَبَخَ بَيْنَ لَابَتَيْنِ It was a fertile land between two lava plains. The Prophet ﷺ was shown Medina and was told that you will be moving to Medina when? Not 3 years after, in the night of Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj. See, the Nazim, we were talking this morning about the prophets that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam met. We know the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam led all the prophets and messengers in that night, but he met specific selected messengers in the heavens. He didn't meet Isa, but he met some others to relate his struggle to their struggle. These prophets, as Sheikh Muhammad Umar Nawawi Al-Jawi mentions, to relate his struggle to their struggle, to show him that you will be striving, and your striving will be related to these specific prophets. If you're facing difficulty with your relatives, Yusuf has faced difficulty with his relatives. If you have difficulty and you need supporter, then you have Ali, who is similar to Aaron. As was Aaron to Moses, Ali will be with you, just like Aaron was to Moses. If you face difficulty from individuals, if you have to face tyranny, then Moses is there to teach him, salawatullah wa salamu alayh, that you have to be an ummah on your own. You have to be a nation on your own. And in order to realize this meaning, you meet Ibrahim. You meet Ibrahim, you are the reviver of the religion and the way of Ibrahim alayhi salam. We need at this time, if we want to look into the prophetic conduct, the highest and the most prominent thing that we need today is to learn from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam at times of difficulties. Leave political analysts to analyze, and leave dreamers to dream, and turn to the one subhanahu wa ta'ala with your needs. Then he will change the realities for you. He will change the dreams for you. He will make your dreams come true. At the most difficult time of the Battle of Badr, many years after, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam turned to Allah. The Sahaba were fighting, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was fighting in a different realm. The Sahaba were fighting in the physical battlefield, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was fighting in the spiritual battlefield, raising his hands to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, asking for help and support. Unfortunately, brothers and sisters, today, loads of people fight in the physical battlefield, but no one fights in that spiritual battlefield. Turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and asking him for his help and support. إِذْ تَسْتَغِيثُونَ رَبَّكُمْ, as Allah says. Only when you ask for إِغَاثَ, for rescue. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَمَّنْ يُجِيبُ الْمُضْطَرُ. He is the one who helps the one who is in dire need. He did not just say, أَمَّنْ يُجِيبُ الدَّاعِي, the one who accepts the dua of the one who asks him. No, you have to be in the state of اضطرار. You have to be in dire need. You have to show that you have no one else except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you want Allah to fill your cup with his help, you got to empty it from anything else. Because the help of Allah comes and your cup is full, then it will go away. You need to empty your heart, you need to empty your mind, you need to empty your body from plans and thoughts and powers. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will help you with his support, and he will cover you, and he will show you subhanahu wa ta'ala things that will bewilder your mind. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will show you things that will bewilder your mind. No one could have ever thought that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's dua would have got him this great response. The greatest response was to take him and lead all prophets. The greatest response is to take him in that night journey and in that ascension that no other prophet has ever been to before. And to show him salawatullah wa salamu alayhi that ahead of you is a great future. Ahead of your nation is a great future. Some years later, the Prophet ﷺ tells us that Allah has given me the four corners of earth. In the middle of the battle of the trench, the Sahaba are busy digging the trench and they are afraid and tired and exhausted. And the Prophet ﷺ tells them, Allah has given me the kingdom of Yemen, the kingdom of Persia, and the Roman kingdom. So we need, brothers and sisters, to look at this great prophetic example that he salawatullah wa salamu alayhi taught us, الدُّعَاء هُوَ الْعِبَادَةِ. The dua is the worship. Dua is the worship. Why is it the worship? Because people sometimes think that they can do things with their themselves. They are deluded with their own minds and powers. But the real ibadah, but the real ibadah is to realize that you are in need of your ma'bud subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala linked seeking help with ibadah. Iyaka na'budu wa iyaka nasta'in. We worship you. You alone we worship, and you alone we turn for help. So if you alone you turn, if you turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone for help, that means your ibadah should be only turning to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala for help. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us istiqama and tawfiq. Aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Muhammad wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.